Hello, everyone. Welcome to this webinar entitled In Vitro Human Airway Modeling Using Primary Airway Epithelial Cells. As a quick outline, we're going to go through the respiratory system, then move on to In Vitro Human Airway Modeling Using Primary Epithelial Cells. We'll go into 2D organoid or air-liquid interface ALI culture, also discuss 3D organoids, and models for airway regional specificity. Then we'll conclude with a summary of key factors leading to success of airway cultures. To begin, the airways are usually designated by structure and order of division. The nomenclature is diverse, proximal versus distal, central versus peripheral, but in this presentation, I'm going to refer to them as large or small airway. The large airway is supported by cartilage, contains the presence of secretory glands and the mucociliary escalator, is surrounded by smooth muscle, and the airway diameter is quite large. And the large airway ends with the bronchioles. Then the small airway starts with terminal non-respiratory bronchioles, and you see the loss of smooth muscle and the loss of cartilage. The airway diameter is also smaller, less than 2 millimeters. And the airway ends with the alveoli, alveolar ducts and alveolar sacs, which together form the respiratory acinus, the basic respiratory unit of the lung where gas exchange takes place. The airway can be divided into different sections based on the branching generations. And you can divide them into large or small airways based on these number of branches. You can also separate airway into different types based on the types of epithelial cells that line the airways. In the large airway, we have the presence of ciliated columnar epithelium and goblet cells, which secrete mucus. And then in the smaller airways, the epithelium become shorter and you lose the presence of goblet cells and instead find the presence of club cells. Then the alveoli contain type 1 and type 2 alveolar cells. They're quite thin and this allows for gas exchange. The most commonly used models for studying human respiratory diseases are either in vivo or in vitro culture models. And this is a chart comparing the different types of models that you could use. And we're comparing cost, accessibility, and physiological relevance. There are in vivo models include rodent or swine non-human primate models, and the cost of these is relatively high. The accessibility is medium to hard, and the physiological relevance is low depending on the model system such as rodent, or if using a non-human primate, of course, it's going to be more similar to humans. But the cost is going to be pretty high. We want to reduce the amount of in vivo modeling that we use, so we can use in vitro culture systems. There are several different types, including transformed cell lines, and the cost of these is relatively low. The accessibility is easy, but the physiological relevance is low because you're using transformed cell lines. In comparison, primary human airway epithelial cells have been well established in the field, and the cost is between low or medium, depending on what you need to obtain for these cultures. The accessibility is good, and the physiological relevance is high. And in between transformed cell lines and primary human airway cells, you have airway cells derived from HPSCs. And the labor associated with these is much higher than primary airway cells. And depending on the medium you use and how you differentiate them, they're more of an early model, whereas primary human airway epithelial cells are more of a mature model of the airway. So throughout this presentation, I can demonstrate that these primary human airway cells are a good model system to be using for a variety of different studies. So moving on, we're next going to discuss in vitro human airway modeling using primary epithelial cells, either 2D organoid or air liquid interface culture, or 3D organoid systems. So in vitro human airway modeling, you can obtain your cells from a variety of different sources, through nasal brushes, through biopsies, cells processed from cadaveric lung, and many of these are available commercially. And what's useful about a lot of these different cell sources is you can get them from different donors, either healthy donors, or depending on what you want to study, different disease donors, from COPD patients, cystic fibrosis patients, asthma, etc. And in this way, you can compare the system to a healthy donor, or depending on the disease model that you want to look at, you can get more into personalized medicine. For example, in cystic fibrosis, you can take a nasal brush from a child and test different treatments on those cells to see what would work best for that patient. And in most of these cases, once you take the brush or the biopsy or you obtain your cells, you're going to expand them in a culture dish or a flask. And this is in submerged culture. So I show human primary bronchial epithelial cells. Now, the most commonly studied of these types of cells are large airway epithelium obtained from bronchial epithelial cells. So this is the epithelial lining of the upper airway and is classified as ciliated pseudostratified columnar epithelium. And these cells contain ciliated cells, and their cilia will have cohesive beading. They will contain goblet cells, which will produce mucus. And basal cells, these small cells at the base, will give rise to the differentiated columnar cells. These usually sit on a basement membrane. ALI cultures, or 2D organoids, have been the gold standard culture model for a long time. In 1988, the Whitcut chamber was the first type of transwell, and is first described by this group. And the characteristics of this is that you have easy access to the apical surface. You can measure cilia beading, ion channel activity, airway surface liquid volume, and mucus secretion. And the system is amenable for co-culture systems. And as you can see with this SEM image, you can see the nice hairy cilia on top of the epithelial cells. So this is a diagram of what you would expect for in vitro human airway modeling, where after you have expanded in 2D in a flask, you can split the cells and either plate them on a transwell insert or into a Matrigel dome for either 2D or 3D organoid systems. So with the 2D organoid, you usually expand the cells for a few days in a expansion media. And then when the cells are confluent, you airlift them or remove the media from the apical side and let the cells differentiate for a few weeks. And usually by 21 days, you see the presence of different cell types that you would see, for example, in the large airway, like goblet cells or ciliated cells. And you can use these for a variety of different experiments. Or you can take the cells and differentiate them in a Matrigel dome. First, you want to expand the cells, and then you can change to a differentiation media. And over 21 or more days, you see the presence of a lumen in the organoids. And the different cell types can be observed, ciliated cell, goblet cell, club cell, depending on the source of your cells. As I said before, you can look at the expression of different markers for the different cell types. So with 2D expansion and then differentiation on a transwell insert, you can see acetylated tubulin, which is a marker for the cilia. You can look at MUC5AC for goblet cells, and you can look at the presence of basal cells with P63. Similarly, in a 3D organoid or closed system, you can see these nice open lumen in the organoids. You can see the presence of goblet cells. And staining for cilia, you can see the nice layer on the epithelial side, or the apical side of the epithelium facing the lumen of these cilia. You can also observe the cilia beading, which is quite impressive to see. So this is in a 2D culture. So if you observe the cells, you can see this is the coordinated cilia beading moving mucus on the top of the cells quite rapidly. And then this is in a 3D organoid system. You can also observe the cilia beading and the mucus or other debris in the lumen swirling around in a coordinated manner. So here's a summary of the comparison of the 2D organoid versus the 3D organoid. And the 2D organoid has 30 years of history, quite expansive, but it's dependent on the insert. So you need to obtain transwell inserts, and these can be expensive. But for an organoid culture system, you need Matrigel, which is also expensive. But the organoid can be done without the insert, and it has the potential for more high throughput applications. So you can generate many different organoids. You can obtain clonal organoids, depending on what you want to look at. If you're going to use CRISPR, you can get organoids that contain all of the same genetics. However, the air liquid interface system, you have easy access to the apical or basolateral sides, the top or the bottom, so you can use them, you can expose them to different drugs or something like smoke, and you can't really access the lumen on the organoid easily. There are some studies that have looked at injection, and we're still working on, you know, trying to get these inside out so that the apical side faces outward. With both of these systems, you can look at the electrophysical properties of these. So with a 2D monolayer, you can look at TER or permeability using Ussing chambers. And with the organoid, you can look at swelling using a Forskalin swelling assay. So now that we've examined the 2D versus 3D organoid culture systems, we can discuss different models for airway regional specificity. So as mentioned previously, there are a variety of different sort of tissue types if you move from the large airway to small airway to the alveolar region. And there's different cells that characterize each region. The large or conducting airway has a columnar pseudostratified epithelium, and certain diseases will affect the large airway versus small airway versus the alveolar region. So when you're deciding on a culture system, you might want to consider choosing a media or choosing cells that might represent that best for you. So in the small airway, you have more cuboidal, thinner epithelium with club cells, and you see the loss of goblet cells. And something like COPD will affect the small airway more than the large airway. And for the alveolar region, you have quite a different cell system. You have these sacs with the alveolar type 1 and type 2 cells. You have the presence of surfactant rather than mucus. And this is the functional unit, and you get gas exchange in the airways. So how can we model, for example, the large airway versus the small airway? So you can obtain different cells from different vendors and use different types of media. And you want to look at the expression of different markers on your epithelial cells that will tell you what type of cells are present. So in the large airway, you're going to see more ciliated cells and about 5 to 10% goblet cells and more basal cells, 20 to 30%. And in this figure, you can see the presence of the tight junction, MUC5AC, the goblet cells, and a ciliated tubulin in green, the nice hairy cilia on top of the epithelium. In comparison, the small airway is quite a bit thinner and contains a greater proportion of ciliated cells and less basal cells. And here we can look at club cell marker or other secretory protein markers like SCGB1A1, or also called CC10. And you might be able to see in your culture system small amounts of neuroendocrine cells, ionocytes, or tuft brush cells. Depending on which marker that you're using, you might be able to see these as well. And there are some studies that have examined using single cell or RNA-seq to examine the different types of populations that are present in these cultures. So now let's go over a summary of the key factors leading to success of airway cultures, keeping in mind the different models for airway regional specificity and 3D versus 2D organoid systems. So there are several key factors leading to successful ALI culture. The cell source, if you're getting them from a nasal brush versus a biopsy versus cells processed from a cadaveric lung, depending on which vendor that you're getting them from, they may react differently in culture and they might grow faster or slower. One good example is if you compare cells from a nasal brush versus those processed from a cadaveric lung, you're going to be getting very few cells in a nasal brush. And they might require more population doublings to be able to cover a whole cell culture dish compared to the number of cells that you might get from another source. So if you're comparing passages, they might be different depending on the source. You also want to keep in mind the type of transwell insert, the pore size and density, the material, and the different vendors, and the media, whether it contains serum or BPE, if you're making it yourself, DIY, or the different vendors have different formulations of media. And we're not going to go into the type of transwell insert or the cell source today, but the next few slides, I'm going to be talking about a comparison of the different types of media and what you could be looking for in your cultures to examine whether or not they'll be useful for you. So here's an example of expansion media comparison. This is expansion media A, B, and C. And if you look at days in culture and the population doublings, depending on which media you use, you might see different growth patterns in your cells, and you want to keep that in mind. So in this case, media A seems to keep the cells doubling for a little bit longer than media B or C. If you look at a slice, a histology section of these epithelial cells comparing expansion media A and expansion media C with differentiation media A and differentiation media B, and across different passages P3 to P8, you can see some differences as the cells progress in their passaging, or you can compare them, you know, at an early stage at P3. So this differentiation media A at P3, you see a nice tall epithelium and cilia, but as you move on to around passage 6 or 7, you see a loss of cilia, and it's becoming shorter and shorter and shorter. So you want to keep in mind that these cells will change over time. They're primary epithelial cells. They can't go on forever. And you want to keep them in a good range of passages and not take them out too far. Also examining different markers. So we have acidulated tubulin. We have the tight junction with ZO1, goblet cells, MUC5AC, and the nuclei is DAPI. And you can see, similar to the previous slide, that the more passaging that you do of these cells, the fewer ciliated cells are present. And comparing media A to media B, you see quite a difference in the number of ciliated cells. And it's a little hard to tell, but there seem to be some goblet cells in there, right? So depending on your model system, you can adjust and go through different vendors and what works best. It's also important for especially cystic fibrosis research to examine ion channel functional assays. So these are oozing chamber tracings, and I'm not going to go into, you know, what is drug A versus B and C and D, but oozing chambers measure short circuit current. It's an electrophysiological property of the epithelial cells, and we're determining the function of CFTR through inhibition and activation by different drugs. And it's not important kind of what the subtle changes in these tracings are, but it's obvious that in this media from passage 3 to passage 7, you're still seeing the clear activation and inhibition of the channel. The tracings are smooth. And in this media, you know, by passage 5, you start to see a loss of the ion channel activity, and these cells aren't so happy in the oozing chambers. So if you're interested in these sorts of things, you got to keep it in mind. If you're passaging the cells, they may change over time again. So there are many applications of the in vitro reconstituted human airway and air-liquid interface. Especially compared to the organoid system, which is closed, this open system allows for apical exposure of many different things, including nanoparticles, gas, smoke. You can apply different bacteria or viruses onto the epithelial cells. They're useful for drug transport studies, toxicity testing, wound repair, and cell biology and molecular signaling in these cells. These cells are useful for preclinical drug development and disease modeling, including COPD, cystic fibrosis, asthma, IPF, lung cancer, and infectious disease. So this was the first half of the webinar. And in the second half, I'm going to go into a little bit more detail about how to use these cultures or their usefulness in studying different viruses. Thank you so much.